Hi, I'm Martha Brockenbrough, and I'm on the faculty at Vermont College of Fine Arts, where I teach in the MFA program for writing for children and young adults. Today, we're going to talk about rhythm and resonance. It's a secret weapon. What makes writing resonant? We know it when we feel it, right? But how can we go from recognizing it when we see it to being able to create it on our own? There are tools we need to understand. These tools are straightforward. They are, in their simplicity, like hammers and screwdrivers, but as with hammers and screwdrivers, they also work better in the hands of people who've practiced. A lot of times with writing, we think that finding words that say exactly what we want to say is the challenge, but this isn't always true. A quiet old lady who is whispering hush is not the same as a quiet old lady whispering shut up. The sound of words makes a difference, and it's not just the sound of individual words as with hush and shut up. It's the sound that the string of words makes. This can transform our scenes. So what are these tools? Well, think music. In its most basic form, music is two things, rhythm and melody. Rhythm is the beat, melody is the pitch. As writers, we can create rhythms and melodies that makes our words rise off the page. It's as close to music as the written word can be. It used to be that writers were schooled in these tools. They learned how to tell the difference between something called an iamb and something called a trochee. They studied when to use each and whether a dactyl or an anapest might serve better. They learned how certain tricks could turn a smart sentence into one that rings with meaning and beauty. And don't worry, I will explain all of these terms in a minute. While you might think this sort of thing is applicable only to poetry, I disagree. I think this is how you make all writing more musical. Now, why is it important that writing be musical? It's not just to sound fancy and flowery. It's because music is important. Every nationality, race, and culture has music. It's more powerful than language in evoking emotion, which is one of our primary, if not the primary, task of a storyteller. Think about it this way. We've all read stories and watched movies we love more than one time. We already know what's going to happen. That's the intellectual content. We watch again because of the emotional content. We want to feel those feelings again. They're the most important part of the story. Music and language are cousins. Both are rooted in brain structures that are involved with motivation, reward, and emotion. When we listen to music, our brains anticipate the next strong beat, just as when we read stories, our brains anticipate what might happen next. In music, this is unconscious. It goes through the cerebellum in the amygdala rather than your frontal lobes. Music violates our expectations of timing, and because our brains know it's music and not a thing going bump in the night, our frontal lobes engage and feel pleasure. We expect to return to the rhythm, and when that happens, boom, there's a feeling of reward. This is all stuff scientists have discovered. I'm not making it up, I promise. And there's more. I think many of us assume that language came first and music came after. No! Researchers at Texas and Maryland theorize that when it comes to music, language, and evolution, music came first. It is a means of communication that precedes and even transcends words. They looked at evidence from a few areas: infant development, language acquisition, and music cognition. So, how do music and language interact with each other? Scientists have come to believe that music comes first and provides the foundation from an evolutionary and developmental standpoint for language acquisition. In other words, music is not a specialized kind of language. Language is a specialized kind of music. So, if you want your writing to hit at the deepest human levels, you'll want to understand how to use rhythm and melody. This exercise is not just for poets, though it certainly is what Shakespeare leaned on for his sonnets and his plays. And while I have mixed feelings about holding Shakespeare or any other dead white guy up as a deity, it's also true that his contributions to the English language are mighty, and that metrical writing, particularly iambic meter, has a powerful hold on our hearts. Da-da. That is an iamb. Here are words that follow the pattern. Surprise, lament, cocoon, balloon, hurrah! I write, therefore I am. Sorry. It's easy to express ourselves this way. I had a roommate freshman year in school. We'd lie in bed and volley back and forth, whatever mundane thoughts might fit the beat. Lots of writers have theories about why this particular meter works so well in English literature. Mary Oliver, in Rules for the Dance, says that in comparison with other patterns, the I am is the least obviously composed, and it's true. Da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. It has a relaxed feel. Nothing like, say, the Medea, a Greek tragedy that's written in dactylic tetrameter. Da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da is more of a gallop than an easy lope. Even so, Mary Oliver's judgment strikes me as one that might exist primarily in the eye of the beholder. Well, she also says that pentameter, lines with 5 feet, happen to be what we can say in a single breath. This is intriguing. Stories, plays, poetry, all things meant originally to be spoken or sung. What's more, 5 is a bit of a magic number. We have 5 senses after all, 5 digits on each limb, flippers, paws, hands. All of these creatures have 5 digits and 5 senses, well, except for sharks, which can sense electromagnetism. This wasn't always so. Before 340 million years ago, in the lower Carboniferous period, tetrapods had 6, 7, even 8 digits. But then vertebrates branched off and 5 went out. So there's magic to 5. 5 beats is the length of a breath. It's also the sum of the senses that help us touch and perceive the world. These sorts of things that are true fill me with wonder. And there's nothing like that. There's nothing that makes me want to write more than filling myself with wonder at the world and its inhabitants. Beyond this, I have an additional theory about why this particular sound, the I am, is a core rhythm and possibly even the heart of lyrical writing. Let's travel back in time, back where my own memories can reach, back to the place where every single human in history has inhabited. This is the womb. The dark and mysterious place where each of us formed. What started as 2 cells became 4, then 8, 16, 32, and so on. It's an unlikely and wild miracle, and in the midst of it, we developed. No 2 of us are alike, but we all have hearts that beat. Except Dick Cheney. He has a pacemaker that doesn't beat. We have limbs and eyes and ears that sense, and while we can never experience the senses exactly as another person experiences them, the principle is basically the same. Our senses are the pathway to the world, perhaps the primary pathway. Of these, touch is the first to develop. This happens around 8 weeks for a developing fetus. Next comes taste and smell. Second to last, just before eyesight, is sound. Here, I don't wish to include deaf people from the experience or from the discussion. Sound waves exist as variations in pressures on mediums such as air. They are created by the vibration of an object. This causes the air surrounding it to vibrate. The vibrating air then makes the eardrum vibrate. The brain interprets this as sound. If the eardrums don't work, other parts of the body can perceive these vibrations. Sound functions a lot like touch, and many people without typical hearing abilities can nonetheless feel the physical sensations of sound. It's hearing just through a different sense. So, a fetus starts to hear at about 24 weeks of gestation when neurons travel to the auditory cortex, the brain region that processes sound. The neurons form connections there. Once the auditory cortex starts to function, a fetus normally hears mostly low-frequency sounds. The first and steadiest of those is its mother's heartbeat. The fetus can also hear the melody of her voice, but it's that rhythmic heartbeat that remains steady throughout. Remember the hungry eyes scene in Dirty Dancing where Patrick Swayze tells Jennifer Grey's character to feel the music, and then he puts her hand over his heart? What does he say? That's right, gugung, gugung. The heartbeat is an I am. It's a sound both heard and felt, and it's uniquely comforting to us, no doubt because it was once our entire world. Let's listen to it. So here's something fascinating from a physician named Noboru Kobayashi, in case you're not persuaded by the allure this particular rhythm has. Whether a mother is left-handed or right-handed, most mothers pick up their babies and cradle them on the left side, as close as the child can get to her beating heart. This is not something that somebody has taught mothers, but rather something mothers have evolved to do automatically. So maybe that's the mystery behind the power of blank verse, of unrhymed iambic pentameter. It is all at once a breath, it is heartbeats, and it is the place where we came into being. Breath, heartbeat, home. All of these things are sustaining forces and the deepest needs of life itself. We all came into this world moving to the rhythm of our mother's heartbeats, comforted by the melody of her voice. It is little wonder that humans sang before they spoke. We are creatures of music. Forget second nature. Song is first nature. It surrounds us as we become us. The more musical we can make our writing, the more we will take the reader straight to the source of their emotions. It's not just about comfort, of course. Rhythm can be steady and comforting, but it can also create urgency. It can be comic. It can terrify. It can generate heat, dry out tears. With melody, rhythm has even more power. Trust in this. There's a reason Shakespeare and Marlowe made use of it, and that strongly rhythmic writing today still rocks our world, sometimes even literally. Okay. So, you know the iamb. It is your heartbeat. It's a rhythm you can use anytime you want your writing to have a certain music to it. There are some additional rhythms to know, beats that will add pleasing variation. Next, this is a trochee. It's the opposite of an iamb. Da 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 da. Once upon a midnight dreary. It's also the theme song of Jaws, and I want you to think about the genius of this melody. The half step, da da, is the most dissonant interval, and the rhythm is the opposite of the beat that gives us life. This song terrifies us using tools of rhythm and melody. But a trochee doesn't have to be terrifying. It can also be charming. Let's spend a little minute enjoying it.
Llama Llama Red Pajama, Ludacris is here.
Okay.
Yeah, man.
The Furious in theaters tomorrow.
Hey, Llama Llama, Red Pajama. Reads a story with who? With his mama. Hey.
Okay. So now you know the iamb, it's your heartbeat. You know the trochee, it's Jaws, or it's Ludacris. Next comes the dactyl. Oops, I'm a little stuck in here. Hang on. A dactyl has three beats. To remember this, look at your finger. There's one long bone and two short ones. Da-da-da, da-da-da, butternut, Ravenclaw, Hufflepuff, Gryffindor, Slytherin, sausage best. These are all dactyls. And then there's the anapest. Understand, contradict. Anapest comes from the Greek word for reverse because it's the reverse of a dactyl. Limericks are anapestic trimeter. There once was a man from Nantucket who kept all his cash in a bucket, but his daughter named Nan ran away with a man, and as for the bucket, Nantucket. Okay, there's also the spondee, which is for two-syllable words or word pairs that are equally stressed. Heartbeat, hey girl, dead end, bookmark, shut up. There are more rhythms than these five, but these five are key. And since we've already established that five is a magical number, I can leave you to explore the additional patterns on your own. I would like to include a caveat. There is no one way to pronounce words. Is it finally or is it finally? There's one firm rule though. You can't expect your reader to mispronounce or misemphasize a word to make your meter work unless you're doing it for comic effect. So a word like elevator is always trochaic. Elevator, it's not elevator. Once you know these basic rhythms, you can use them to create the rhythm of your work. In a picture book, you might decide, for example, that you're using a dactylic rhythm. But there's more than just figuring out the rhythms. When you're figuring out the meter of something, you not only look at the basic pattern the words make, but you also look at how many of those patterns are in each line. Okay, so units of rhythm are called feet, like an IM is going to be a foot. Each line is going to have a certain number of feet. So 4 dactyls per line is a dactylic tetrameter. So that's the next thing that you want to do, is you want to count out the meter, you establish your meter, and then you count the feet of it. Now, entire novels won't be written this way, most likely. You could. Entire novels have been written without punctuation or without the letter E. But the power of rhythm to evoke emotion remains. You can vary the meter if you're writing in verse, so you might throw in some anapests or spondees with your dactyls for variety. Remember what I said earlier about music. When the pattern is established and then violated, it gives us a jolt of pleasure. So inject that pleasure when it serves your piece. That said, you probably don't want to interrupt the rhythm too much if you're working on something shorter. Let's say you're writing a picture book in verse. You probably want to keep the same number of feet throughout. This is like the time signature in music. A waltz keeps 3/4 time. No matter what, people can keep dancing to that. Yes, there will be exceptions, but you want to make sure they serve your story and you're not just giving up. All right, so now the next thing to do is to practice scansion. Scansion is the art of figuring out the basic meter and the number of feet in a line. The first thing you do is figure out the meter, and then you count the feet. So here's what scansion looks like. If you've got a poem and you're practicing, you can mark it up. The angle is for a stressed syllable, and the little curve is for the non-stress. Seen from above, the sky is deep. Clouds float down there. Foam on a long, luxurious bath, their shadows over limbs submerged in air. This is what I do. If I write something in meter and I'm trying to hold to it, I will mark it up to make sure that I've done my job correctly. All right, so now we're gonna practice figuring out scansion. If music be the food of love, play on. Da 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 da. We can see da 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 is the meter. This is iambic pentameter because there's 5 of these feet. Okay. Once upon a midnight dreary, while I pondered weak and weary. Da 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 da. There's 8 feet, and these are all trochees, so this is trochaic octimeter. Okay, the third example is the charge of the light brigade. Cannon to the right of them, cannon to the left of them, cannon in front of them, volleyed and thundered. This is called dactylic dimeter. So here's a dactyl, the da, 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 and there's 2 dactyls in each line. That's what makes it dactylic dimeter. Not a word to each other, we kept the great pace, neck by neck, stride by stride, never changing our place. Okay, so we have anapests, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. And we have 4 of them each line, so that makes it tetrameter. Anapestic tetrameter. Here's another example. Were he not gone, the woodchuck could say whether it's like this long sleep as I describe it's coming on or just human sleep. Those are spondees, and yes, that was a tricky one. It can sometimes get difficult. A spondee is the 2 stressed syllables back to back. Okay, there's an additional trick that you can use with your meter, and it's called a caesura. This is a pause for emphasis. It happens in music all the time, and it works just the same way in verse. Sing a song of 6 pence, pause, a pocket full of rye, 4 and 20 blackbirds, pause, baked in a pie. When the pie was opened, the birds began to sing. Isn't that a dainty dish to set before the king? Okay. So let's talk. Oops, I got ahead of myself with my slides and I ruined my joke. I'm still gonna do it. Let's talk more specifically about when being deliberate about the meter of your words is useful in your writing. I could argue that it's useful all the time, but for the sake of starting someplace small and someplace important, let's consider a couple of specific examples. Let's say you're writing a rhyming picture book. Yes, there can be pitfalls with the rhyme of these. You know a forced rhyme will never fly, and an empty rhyme won't serve your book. But if you're really struggling to nail the voice of your picture book, or something isn't working with your rhyme, and you can't figure out why, there's a chance because you need to feed the meter. There's my joke, and I'm not sorry about it. Okay, even if you're not trying to write a rhyming picture book, coming up with a meter for your lines, creating your own rhythm pattern, you will almost certainly make your book more lyrical. It will feel like poetry or music, even if it's not. So if you're struggling with a passage in your book, it's worth a try. And later, I'm going to show you how you can take an absolutely terrible piece of writing and make it not suck simply by making it metrical. Okay, so let's say you have no intention of writing a picture book. When might you focus on the meter of your prose? What has this to do with writing a novel or a short story? Well, think about your favorite lines from books. Chances are there is some beauty to them that you struggle to pinpoint. Is it the character, the conflict, the anticipation? I'd be willing to bet many of these outstanding lines you love so much have a metrical symmetry to them that thrilled your heart. You were so caught up in the reading that you might not even have noticed. Try it though, the next time you come across a truly beautiful line in a book, study how it sounds, scan its meter, and then tattoo it on your mind or your arm. I ink, therefore I am. Ha ha, another one, I'm unstoppable with the puns. All right. So this set of lines is from my novel, The Game of Love and Death, and I wrote them carefully to sound a certain way. Someday, everyone you love will die. Someday, everything you love will crumble to ruin. This is the price of life. This is the price of love. This is the only ending to every true story. There's a rhythm to these sentences, rhythm that was a pleasure to craft and fine-tune. But it's not just the meter of the lines that carry the music here. And this brings me to a second set of tools that you can pair with rhythm to make your writing musical. Here I'm talking about rhetorical devices. Some of them are familiar, maybe to the point of being cliched. Take, for example, alliteration, the repetition of sounds. As adorable as Alice the Alligator might be, as winning as Warren the Warthog sounds, this has been done to death. So while you certainly can do this, it's not enough to elevate your writing and it might actually sink it. There are other ways alliteration works, though. And it's not just alliteration. There's other rhetorical devices that play here, but one thing at a time, okay? So, this is the price of life. This is the price of love. Here we have P's and L's repeated in two sentences that have identical meter. The alliteration and parallel meter make them feel parallel to each other and links life with love, enriching the theme of my book. I could have written these sentences in other ways. You know how your school teachers always taught you to vary your diction to keep writing interesting? Sometimes this is bad advice. I could have written it like this. This is what it costs to live. Love has a price tag too. The first sentence is in trochaic pentameter, minus an unstressed syllable. It's not a bad sentence, and the second has a metaphor. There's even assonance in the V sound of live and love, but I'd say that alliteration doesn't serve as well as the echo of life and love. You make those sounds using slightly different parts of your lips. More important though, that O sound is deeper than the I sound, and that plunging feeling it gives is what I wanted my readers to feel in their chests. This is what transforms ink on the page to a physical experience. If writing doesn't have poetry, if it doesn't have music, it doesn't ring like truth. And even when it imparts the same information to the reader, it doesn't evoke the same or sufficient emotion. And this can be deadly to your scenes. Now, focusing on the music of your writing isn't necessarily something you need or want to do with every single sentence of your novels, but you very much do at the key moments. Here, think of language as light. This moment in my story comes at the end of the first chapter, and it's a key moment marking the inciting incident of the game. Love and death have chosen their players. Life will never be the same for Henry and Flora, my characters. And the language here throws a spotlight on the scene. So what are the moments in your story that deserve this powerful illumination? How can you turn that line into a poem or into a lyric that matches the tone of your book and elevates it in such a way that your reader gets goosebumps? Okay, that's what you want to do. And now, it thrills me to no end to sit here and read the worst thing that has ever been read in a writing class. It's a portion of a Kenmore dishwasher manual. Here goes. Your dishwasher has the latest technology in dishwasher filtration. This triple filtration system minimizes sound and optimizes water and energy consumption while providing superior cleaning performance. Throughout the life of your dishwasher, this filter will require maintenance to sustain peak cleaning performance. The triple filter system consists of two parts, an upper filter assembly and a lower filter. The upper filter assembly keeps oversized items and foreign objects along with the very fine food particles out of the pump. The lower filter keeps food from being recirculated into your dishware. Did you manage to stay awake? Did that make you feel anything? I mean, besides pity for the poor sap who had to write it, the other sap who had to edit it, and the desperate consumer trying to figure out how to use the pot scrubbing function? You know what this dishwasher manual really needs? A heaping spoonful of Shakespeare. So, here it is in blank verse, as though Shakespeare would have written it. So blank verse is unrhymed iambic pentameter. This silver box that stands before you now, a silent miser with your precious water, This silver box that stands before you now, a silent miser with your precious water, it has not one, not two, but three thin sheets to catch the nasty dregs of food that swirl as sparrows in a violent storm do fly. And so it's urgent that you clean these filters. The one on top will keep your pump in check, the lower one protects your stuff from sludge. If you can take rhythm and rhetorical devices to make a dishwasher manual sound vaguely Shakespearean, think of what you can do in a story with characters in moments of agony and joy. You can write something that will make someone laugh, weep, get a tattoo, break a heart open, or change the world. I'll end by quoting Willy Wonka, quoting Arthur O'Shaughnessy's Ode, because what else would I do to show you the power of mastering rhythm? We are the music makers, and we are the dreamers of dreams. Go forth and dream your dreams and sing your songs. The world needs nothing less from you.